Praise the Lord. Welcome, friends, today to Spirit of Grace Hour on television. I'm your regular host, Dr. Nick Mbezwe Daniel. It's my pleasure to come your way today again with the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for tuning in. The Lord will do us good together today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Today we want to continue our teaching on a topic I titled, Putting on the Whole Armor of God. I say that again, putting on the whole armor of God. The Bible enjoins us as believers to put on the whole armor of God. Amen. And I'm taking my reading today from Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 to 11. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 to 11. Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 11. And he says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. He said, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Whole armor of God, what is it? What is whole armor of God? We get a clue of what the whole armor of God is if we look at verse 13. If you scroll down on that same Ephesians chapter 6, we just read verse 10 and 11, just go down to verse 13. It says, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God. He mentions the armor of God again. That ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all things, to stand. To stand. Having done all things, to stand. That is to say, the armor helps you to be able to stand against all attacks, against all the wiles of the enemy. So the purpose of kitting up yourself in the whole armor of God is so you can stand. I want you to take note of that. The purpose of the whole armor of God as a believer is so you can stand for God. So by comparing one letter of Paul, Ephesians, Paul's letter to the Ephesians, with another letter that Paul wrote to another group of people, we are able to see what was in the mind of Paul when he wrote this letter. So I decided to make a comparison, scripture to scripture. I decided to look for another place where Paul mentioned this so we can see exactly what it was in the mind of Paul as he wrote. And you find that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 1. 1 Corinthians 15 verse 1. In this, Paul says, let me read that to you. He said, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you. I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye received, and wherein ye stand. The gospel which I preached unto you, which also you received, and wherein you stand. So you see that receiving the gospel, there are three key things Paul mentioned here. One is the preaching. Two is the receiving of the gospel. And the third and most important, the result, the effect of that, of preaching and receiving of the gospel, is to stand. He said, wherein ye stand. So we see that in the first verse we read from Ephesians 6, he said, put on the whole armor of God so that you can stand. Here he said, I preach the gospel to you, you receive the gospel, and you are standing in it. So by this we can deduce that the whole armor of God is the gospel. In science they say QED, which means you've been able to establish this. We have established that the whole armor of God is the gospel, because if you receive the gospel and you stand, And if you put on the whole armor of the of God, you stand. It means that the whole armor of God is the gospel. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And we for in the Paul's letter, I confirmed it again with another letter that Paul wrote to another group of people called the Romans. In Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul said, let me read that to you. Let me not be talking from my head. Let me just read that to you. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Romans 1, 16. He says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation for everyone that believeth. So the gospel is the power, is the armor of God. The moment you receive the gospel and you are living in Christ and Christ is living in you, you have automatically equipped yourself with the armor of God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I want us to pray this morning. Father, in the name of Jesus, today we thank you for the privilege to dig into your word one more time. We are not relying on enticing words of man's wisdom, but a demonstration of your spirit and of your power. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Let every hearer right now be illuminated with the grace of God in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Praise the Lord. When you receive the gospel, Paul says, you stand. When you stand, you don't need anybody to follow you. You know what you have received, and you are standing on it. Peter and John said, whether it is better to hearken to man or hearken to God, judge ye. For we cannot but speak the things our eyes have seen and our hands have handled of the word of God. When you receive the gospel, the result is that you stand. Praise the Lord. As you renew your mind in the word of God, as you God opens your eyes, the eyes of your understanding, to begin to understand the things of God, automatically you are taking on strength and you are becoming dangerous to the kingdom of darkness. That is when you are kitted with the full armor of God. So I want us to look at what is this armor. We go back to our scripture in Ephesians 6. Go back to Ephesians 6 and see what are this armor the Paul was talking about. What is this armor that Paul was talking about in Ephesians 6? He said, stand therefore, having your loins. I'm reading from verse 14. Ephesians 6, 14. He says, stand therefore, having your loins girt with the truth. Your loins, the most sensitive part of you, you get it with the truth. Your loins girt with the truth. What is the truth? The Bible says, the law came by Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. So when you are talking of truth, you are not leaving grace behind, because grace and truth are a package, same package. You buy one, you get one free. John chapter 1, verse 16 to 17 said, the law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. So when you are talking about Jesus Christ, when you are talking about grace and truth, you are talking about Jesus Christ. John chapter 1, verse 16. The law is the shadow, while the truth is Christ. I say that again. The law is the shadow of the new covenant. But the truth, the new covenant, the grace covenant, is Christ. Praise the Lord. So under the new covenant, truth frees us from the law as a basis of right standing with God. Truth frees us from the law as the basis for right standing with God. We'll see that in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. 2 Corinthians 3, 16. We'll see that explain further. He says, nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord Jesus Christ, the veil shall be taken away. He said, now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. I told you that the law, the truth in Jesus Christ frees us from the law as a basis of right standing with God. He said, when the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. He said, but we all, as with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of God. So we see that when he comes, he says, guard your loins with the truth. In other words, circumcise yourself with the truth of the gospel. And when you do that, it liberates you from obeisance to the law as a basis of right standing with God. What a freedom that is. What a freedom many yet have to enter, and they are not aware of it. And that is the purpose of preaching, is to bring many unto righteousness of Christ, to bring many into the rest of God. The Bible said there remaineth the rest for the people of God. Wherein ye take it that you enter into it. That is the purpose of the gospel. Praise the Lord. So many Christians describe someone as a brother or sister of good standing in the Lord. He said, this is a brother of good standing. You see pastors, you see Christians describe one another. Say, this man is a person of good standing in the Lord. But what do they mean by that? Sometimes, most times what they mean is that this brother is a person of integrity among the believers. And how do they judge that? He comes to church regularly. He participates in the things of God, in the work of the gospel. He pays his tithes. He gives offerings. He comes out for all night prayers and all that. When they look at the man, they say, this brother is of good standing in the Lord. But this is man's measurement. Zealousness in the things of the church, or zealousness towards the pastor, does not equate to good standing, according to Paul, from what we have the verses of scripture we have read now. Good standing, according to Paul, is standing with the full armor of God, standing in the gospel, the power of God unto salvation. So on the contrary, if you receive the light of the good news, in fact, it's not just good news, it's good, too good to be true news. The gospel is too good to be true news. That's why it's called amazing grace. When you are standing in the light of that, you'll be standing tall in Christ automatically. So a brother of good standing is one, according to Paul and according to my gospel, is one who has received the gospel, who has received Christ. The Bible says, Christ in you, the hope of glory, who is no longer looking at do's and don'ts as a basis of right standing with God, but rather looking at the finished work of Christ and resting on it for good standing with God. That's the person you can say is a good standing Christian. Praise the Lord. All these other things are good, but they will be easier for you when you have done the right thing, which is receiving the gospel, trusting in the finished work of Christ, not in your own self-works or self-righteousness or legalism, but rather trusting in Christ. When you do that, the Bible says the love of God will be shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Ghost. He said, for the love of God, Romans chapter 5, verse 5, he said, the love of God is shed abroad in your heart, in our hearts, by the Holy Ghost. The love of God. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. So it's not a will thing. It's a grace thing. When you receive the gospel, embrace the finished work of Christ, and trust upon the work of Christ as the basis for your right standing with God, the Bible said the love of God will automatically be shed abroad from your heart by the Holy Ghost. And when you do these things, you do them on the basis of love, not on the basis of self-works. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So what are the components of this armor? I'll return to that again. So what are the components of this armor? After truth, it talks about breastplate of righteousness. Let's look at that again. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 14. Ephesians 6, 14. It talks about, it says, having your loins get in the truth, we have discussed about the truth, and then having on the breastplate of righteousness. What is the breastplate of righteousness? Righteousness that comes via revelation, not by the will of man. It says, born of again, not of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man. Righteousness that is not, Romans chapter 1 verse 7. Let's look at Romans chapter 1 verse 17. Romans 1 17. Go back to Romans 1 17. He said, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel, backing up to verse 16. He said, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and to the Greek. Verse 17. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. The righteousness of God is revealed. So the breastplate of righteousness is not a man's will thing. It's a revelation of righteousness. You don't see it, but you acquire it through believing. That first of all, you believe that God loves you. Many people find it difficult to love themselves. So it's difficult for them to believe that God loves them. They look at themselves, they judge themselves as unlovable, maybe because of their behavior or because of the way people have treated them. They've not seen love from people towards themselves. Neither have they loved themselves. And it's difficult for them to relate to the fact that God loves them unconditionally. But the Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 10, it says, herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and gave his son to become a propitiation, to become a replacement, to become a substitute for us on the cross. So, first of all, the revelation of righteousness is that you receive and you believe and you understand and you know that God loves you. Praise the Lord. The second part of it is that you believe that God is not angry with you. God is no longer angry with mankind. When you are in Christ, you see that in Romans chapter 1, chapter 5, verse 1. It says, therefore we have peace. Therefore we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God has made peace with man. Every man that comes to receive Jesus Christ, comes to God on the basis of Christ, has made peace with God. So God is not angry with you. So the revelation of righteousness is, first of all, that God loves you. Two, that God is not angry with you. He has said he will not be angry with you anymore. Taking God at his word, and believing that God, Christ has exchanged your sin, and in exchange for your sin, giving you his own righteousness. Christ, the sinless Lamb of God, exchanged his sinlessness with mankind by taking our sins and giving us his righteousness. So this is revealed. That's why the Bible says the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. It's a faith thing. It's not a measurement of how good you are, how long you pray, how much offering you give, how you help the poor, how you speak to people without cursing. Those are good, but that's not a measurement. It's a faith thing. Believing that Christ took your sin and gave you his righteousness. And now you have received the righteousness, you are righteous before God. That's the breastplate of righteousness. Then he goes on to the next one. He said, and your feet, verse 15, shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Preparedness, willingness to spread God's love after you receive it, is the surest proof that you have received it. your willingness, your eagerness, just like I'm doing right now, I'm taking out my time, coming on air, taking all the trouble to communicate God's love, is the only surest proof that you have it. Because if you have the love of God, it will speak. It will speak. Jesus said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. He said, a new commandment I give you, love one another, even as I have loved you. So the only love you can give is the love that you receive from God. Because you are not able to love yourself enough. But if you receive from God, you can give. You can love. Praise the Lord. So preparedness to preach the gospel is another armor. And that armor is very effective. That armor is a very strong armor. The gospel is preached unto you. You receive the gospel. You stand kitted with the armor of God. And you are giving out. You are preaching the gospel. That is a proof, another proof, that you are kitted with the armor of God. We have that in Romans chapter 10, verse 14. Romans 10, 14. Book of Romans chapter 10, verse 14. I want to read that too. Romans 10, 14. It says, how shall they call on him whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how they shall they hear without a preacher? So, moving out and preaching the gospel is one of the armor you put on after you have received the gospel. Finally, faith. He said, believing in him whom you have not seen. Faith. That is verse. He said, taking the helmet. Verse 16 says, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherein you are able to quench all the fiery darts. The shield of faith, the armor of faith. Faith means you believe God's word. He said, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue that rises against you is condemned. You shall condemn. So you are taking the God upon his word. He said, in blessing I have blessed you. In multiplication I have multiplied you. Taking God at his word is called the shield of faith. You believe it. It's whatever comes at you, the shield of faith is there to buffer you from the attacks of the enemy. He said, believing in him who you have not seen. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 8. Peter, I round up with that scripture. He says, 2 Peter verse 1, chapter 1, verse 8. He said, ye have believed on him whom you have not seen. That is faith. He said, for if this is be in you, abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, if this is be in you, they make you so fruitful that you abound in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. In verse 18, he says, and this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mountain. Praise the Lord. Praise God. So I want to round up my message today by saying that the whole armor of God is the gospel. You receive, the gospel is preached, you receive the gospel, you believe it, and the Bible said, therein ye stand. When you receive the whole armor of God, the purpose is for you to stand. If you have yet to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, what a world I'm inviting you into today. Take your time. Receive the gospel. Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. God is calling all mankind. It doesn't matter what you have done. It doesn't matter what life you are. It doesn't matter what tag the world has given you. Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, whatever. The Bible says, whosoever calleth upon on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I yield my life to you. Today, I surrender unto you as my Lord and my personal Savior. Once you do that prayer and you receive Christ, you are into a new world. It's called rest. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Join tune in next week. Same channel, same station, and we shall continue this station. I now hand you over to my announcers for the rest. God bless you.
This broadcast is sponsored by Grace in Full Missionary Association, GIFMA in short, an international Bible missions group. We're so grateful for your audience today.
We welcome your comments, inquiries, and any other forms of feedback you may have. You can visit our website, www.gifma.us, or send us an email at spiritofgrace.gifma.us@gmail.com.
If you need prayer or counseling, give us a call, 346-754-0720.
Also, follow our Facebook page, GIFMA, that's G-I-F-M-A.